Okay, ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. We'll begin our next technology presentation. Up on stage, please help me welcome Freedom Dorsch from Trump, talking about process sensors and keys to Industry 4.0.
Oh, thank you for the nice introduction. Good morning, everybody. At least those that are already available here and ready to listen. As announced, I'd like to give you some insights on Industry 4.0 aspects and to get all this data in Industry 4.0 filled in. We have to have some things that go into that or create this data, which are one example are process sensors. That is for Trump, it's very important. Trump is a big company. Most likely, many of you know them. It's a family-owned and family-managed business since 95 years. We are basically busy in two technology fields, which are machine tools and lasers. Here I focus, of course, a little bit on the laser part. We have subsidiaries worldwide and a decent growth over the last years, so doing fine. Regarding our laser business, basically we dedicate our lasers to every industrial application and even to some scientific applications. We are familiar with almost any application of lasers. To do that, we have a large variety of different types of lasers because not one laser can address all the applications, starting with CO2 lasers, thin disk lasers, both usually are CW lasers, diode lasers, expanding to fiber lasers, pulse lasers, ultra-short pulse lasers, Mach lasers. We have all types of lasers basically available that are used in industrial applications. It's not only the laser that creates the process, but that entire process depends on the machine, on the laser, as I mentioned. There's an optics in between that puts the laser beam onto the workpiece. We have sensors that monitor the processes, that monitor the machines, and additionally, we have services. The entire thing, that is a solution that the customer and the user is asking for. In this presentation, I'd like to focus now on the sensor part here. Just an example of different types of sensors that we are using in our systems, in our machines. We have seam tracking sensors and seam monitoring sensors that require to determine that we weld or process at the right position. We have sensors that determine the weld depth during welding to determine, to measure the weld depth. We have a temperature control weld travel monitoring that are sensors particularly for plastics welding. Temperature control also is used for hardening processes. Okay, we have barcode code grading that are sensors reading back from marked systems. We have position correction values, sensors that look if your workplace is on the right position and correct gives this offset back to the feeding machine to make sure that the process works, is created or done at the right position. I want to focus a little bit here, just short examples about seam tracking, weld depth monitoring, and position correction, and a little bit deeper, just a few slides more on temperature control for plastics welding. One example for seam tracking sensors, and seam tracking for us is an old business that we do that since 20 years. There are different flavors of this type of sensors. Basically, all are looking for a gap or for a step where we want to weld, where the joint is supposed to be. Then we determine this position of this steps of this feature and control the actual position in closed loop. We do that for many years using cameras and laser line projectors, using light section measurements, which are very robust, very well established. It's a coaxial measurement, and we can do that during the process that we have a closed loop control also position. And this type of sensor can be applied to fixed optics as well as scanning optics, scanner optics, and that example here refers to our scanner optic where we have the sensor, the camera. Doesn't work that well. We have this camera placed on top of the sensor, and in the forerun we have a laser line projectors to illuminate the workpiece. Disadvantage or restriction of this type of sensor is that we have a certain preferred direction, because where the light is, where we have the line projectors, that is the feeding direction. If you want to do that omnidirectionally, particular with a scanning laser, then we use a scanning OCT sensor that probes the surface, creates a similar type of image, and then we do the same with that. So it's different types of sensors or measurement generators on the same system. And this, at the same time, we do not only control the position, but we also measure the seam shape, the seam geometry, to get characteristic figures from them that characterize the quality. All the data are stored and then are available for later analysis and for statistics and whatever the final customer wants to do with that. There was a presentation about that by my colleague Jan Hermann yesterday, so there will be more details given also in the proceedings if anybody is interested. Another example for sensing is measuring the depth of the capillary, which basically corresponds to the depth of the weld. That is something you want to know: how deeply do I weld? Do I can weld deeply enough to connect my pieces? That is also done by using an OCT, which is basically an interferometer, that distance measurement, where we determine the distance or the depth of the capillary. There is a presentation by my colleague Tim this afternoon, and I think he's touching base on that a little bit too. Another simple, well, not simple, sounds simple, this system for sensors is our vision line series, which is basically a coaxial camera mounted to the work to the processing optics, and with a strong image processing behind that. And from that, that is very customer friendly. We can determine, or the customer determine different features, measure the positions, and feed this features or these positions from the workpiece back to the machine to make sure that all offsets, all variations in positions are corrected, and that the process then afterwards is done at the right position. Here are some examples given. These are on the right hand side two hairpins from electromotors where you want to make sure that you determine the gap is not too wide, and you want to make sure that the pins are at the right position before you weld to have a good electrical contact afterwards. I mentioned at the beginning I want to go a little bit deeper, just a few slides more, on the temperature control sensor. We use a pyrometer that is coaxially built into our welding optics. Here we have as an example, a scanner optic where we have the, you don't see that, yeah. I don't see it from this side. Where we have the temperature, the pyrometer attached to that, and so we measure the temperature of the workpiece, of the processing area during the process, and then we have a feedback loop to the laser power to control the laser power to make sure that it has the right temperature during the process. And that is used for plastics welding, because you want to make sure that your plastic is molten but not burned, and the amount of energy that you deposit then, or the that you need to get it molten, depends on the workpiece itself, but also on the surrounding, on the heat flow, or the heat dissipation on the different pieces. For instance, on the right-hand side, there is a structure on the plastic. So if we control the temperature very nicely. So we had a nice weld of this zigzag path. On the lower one, there is no temperature control switched on. And there is this cross in behind, which is a missing or feature inside the plastic because of other reasons. So there is a different thermal resistor, or thermal flow when this laser beam in the zigzag crosses these positions. So you see these burning marks because you just apply too much laser power at that instance. And if you have the temperature control turned on, you very quickly determine the actual temperature at the spot, and you can use the laser power and avoid all this melting, all this burning of this, the plastic. And on the left-hand side, you see we not only show the data and make a closed loop measurement with that, we also store all the data for later analysis, for statistics, to give it to the customer. And that is just an example of one type, which type of process data we create. And for all the other sensors that I showed, we also have a lot of data that we then eventually can feed into the overall system. It starts, of course, with the workpiece ID. Do you want to identify correlate the data to the individual workpiece? You read the workpiece from ID from your PLC. Then this the laser via the laser the data are transferred to the pyrometer, to the sensor system, does the software control, and at the end all the data are stored in our QDS, which is our quality data storage system for intermediate storage. And then from that perspective or from that point, there are interfaces to external systems. We cannot store, of course, the history of all data for the manufacturing company. Part of this entire system is also visualization that you can do on, directly on your system, that you look compare data for the last work pieces that you processed. So you can do a first analysis, first visualization, before you then eventually store that in other system for more statistical evaluations. So that is our idea. The sensors with the process data feed into this QDS system, but not only the sensor data, but also the laser. Our lasers and the machines, they also have a lot of sensors built in to determine the characteristics, the performance of the machine. For instance, we monitor the laser power, the cooling water temperature, pressures of gases and everything. So all this data are stored or are measured and can be stored and fed into the same system, so that we have a full correlation possibility between process data of the individual workpiece and the data of the respective machine at that instant. So that is our part to Industry 4.0. At the end, the customer wants to have a transparent and process with a lot of data and full traceability. And of course, he wants to connect that to his MRP system. So he places an order. An order will be entered, will be managed. Material is procured. Then the final work or the work, the process, production process is done. Product is ready, and it goes for logistics, and then is shipped to the customer and gets a bill. That's the process flow from that perspective. And where we are, Trumpf are, is in the machine, in the area where the production takes place, where we have our machine. So in that instance, we correlate this data or feed the data of the sensors into this system, the data system. And at the same time, we have the smart services where we can get the information from the machines into that. So we can correlate all that and have that available at the center part of the Industrial 4.0 approach. That is where we see ourselves, and we have standard interfaces in and out of this cross, that this horizontal flow is fulfilled. So, at the end, of course, we want to have a full transparency, full availability of all data. It starts, of course, first with safety-relevant parts and quality-relevant parts. We want to store and trace important information first, in particular, for instance, for airbag elements or something like that. Next step would be visualize the data. We do that already. We have dashboards where we can correlate show correlation between different type of data from machines as well as from processes. Then we can close to analyze these things there. We need possibly external systems. And at the end, we might feed all the information that we can create from this entire chain into a larger system, machine learning system, artificial intelligence system, that they can eventually then improve themselves and get additional insights of information. That is where we see the laser process in the next decade, or the way it's going. Thank you for your attention.